So I told you I've been doing stand-up for several years in Norway, and when I started, I was surrounded by Norwegian Vikings. And like I told you, I was talking about the same issues as them, because that's what stand-up comedians do, right? They talk about sex, religion, taboos, and I did the same. And I started receiving these threats, and they got worse and worse. And you know, there were no limit to how far people were willing to go with words. And when one guy said to me, they were waiting outside the comedy stage, and they keep telling me and asking me, why are you talking about sex? And then he just said, I know what you really want. You know, what you really, really want is a white cock in your mouth. That will shut you up. And he's right. It will. And I told him, when I'm done with that white cock, I will speak again. And it was right after that, I went to this nightclub where Mullah Krekar was performing. He was promoting his new book. I just noticed the poster outside the nightclub that Mullah Krekar is going to tell his story. And I was thinking, okay, a mullah in a nightclub, I think that's very good. So I went inside and I had to give the mullah that. The nightclub was packed. It was sold out. It was the usual cabaret crowd, journalists and a lot of lesbians. And the mullah, he was this Mullah Krekar, he was wanted by the CIA for being an alleged terrorist. He had trained in Pakistan and was linked to Al-Qaeda. And he was living in Norway as a refugee. But Norwegian human rights law were protecting him. Meanwhile, he was promoting jihad and Sharia laws. So this mullah was using his freedom of speech and alcohol. He was telling people that alcohol is totally forbidden in front of drunk people. And I thought, is that really happening? A mullah in a nightclub? I had to go and talk to him. And the mullah who has been accused of promoting terrorism was defending himself. He said he was not a threat to national security, and Norwegians have no reason to be afraid of him. I could see that the audience didn't believe him. There was a feeling of fear in the room. It made me think, and isn't it our fear which is giving this man his power? And then he asked for questions. And I found myself raising my hand and I said, Mullah Krekar, I can help you to show that you are not a dangerous man. It will take less than 30 seconds. And then I went upstage and I lifted him up. But the room, with all that fear, they start laughing. See, everyone, the mullah is harmless. But when the mullah realized what had happened, his face went crazy. And he said, it's an insult to be lifted by a woman. It is written that a woman should not lift a man. But Mullah Krekar, isn't Sharia an insult to all women? Isn't being stoned to death if you become pregnant before marriage an insult to human beings? And isn't the law that you should be hanged if you're homosexual an insult to humanity? Well, the next day, the police called me and said I was being accused by the mullah for sexual harassment. Really? In a nightclub? Okay, the police dismissed the case. They said there were no proof of sexual harassment. I think I lifted him because I wanted to get the fear out of the room. I thought I was going to see a historic event. I didn't know that I was going to be the historic event, that this would become the lift heard around the world. Even the New York Times covered it. And from the letters I received, I realized that for some Muslims, what I did, a woman lifting a mullah, was literally unbelievable. A girl from Karachi sent me an email asking me if the news clip she was seeing was cartoon. Some people condemned me for what I did, saying it was disrespectful, and some praised my courage. I was told that Mullah Krekar was personally responsible for the torture and death of several people. One Iraqi told me that in Iraq, if anyone dared to laugh in front of Mullah Krekar, they had to pay him. You laugh, you pay. Yeah, actually, that is something we had in common. In the press, the lift became a hot topic of debate. The left wing said I had become too Norwegian, that I had forgotten my roots, I shouldn't disrespect a man of religion. The right wing said, lifting him, I should have thrown him out of the country. So because of my new fame as a world-famous mullah lifter, I was invited to open the Norwegian Film Festival. You know, it's like the Norwegian Oscar. I was invited to introduce a romantic comedy which was considered very controversial because it was a story about the forbidden love between a Muslim girl and a Norwegian boy who marries her. And who is better to introduce that story than the mullah lifter herself? So I said yes before I saw the movie. Uh-oh. The happy ending is that to be accepted by the girl's family, the boy agrees to get circumcised, convert to Islam, and if he ever attempts to ask for a divorce, he agrees in a written contract to be murdered by the bride's family. Hello? Is that a happy ending? This was meant to be a movie which was supposed to build bridges between cultures. No kidding. But I had accepted the invitation. It would be very rude and unfair of me to not show up. So I went up on stage and I said, listen, Norwegian and Pakistanis have been living together for more than two generations. It shouldn't be controversial that they are sleeping, kissing, making babies, whatever, together. So I decided I will make a very short, less than 30 seconds, statement about the difference between what I thought was controversial and what the movie thought was controversial. I turned around and I mooned the audience. And believe me, it was a full moon. Showing my ass was controversial enough to cause real violence. You know, the Pakistani girl in this movie, she had no lines. She was accepting whatever the agreement with the males. 4 a.m. the next morning, some people in a car drove by our family restaurant and shot 18 bullets through the window. It was a message to me to keep my mouth shut. And now they were threatening my whole family. I guess lifting a terrorist mullah wasn't dangerous, but mooning the audience was. Also, we see naked women asses in the media every day. I do. but an ass that had something to say? A Pakistani ass? Now that's deadly. So in the press, I was attacked by some Norwegian as being too outrageous, provocative, and pushing the limits too far. But my sister, who owned the restaurant, did something I will never forget. She said to me, "Look into my eyes. It's not your fault." If this had been an Italian mafia movie, like The Godfather, I would, of course, have gone back to where my family originally came from, you know, just to feel safe again. I thought the only way I know my family and I could be safe is that I had to leave the Kingdom of Norway. And I have to go into exile. But going back to Pakistan, this will not be a good idea. You know, there you hardly show your ass to your doctor. In Pakistan, you're not supposed to have any ass. And the Pakistani press, they have also covered the story, but instead of asking who did the shooting, they were featuring me as the blasphemous burqa stripper from Norway who mocks Islam. And they also published a blackout pictures of my ass. So now I was receiving death threats from the mullahs and their followers and marriage offers from horny young Pakistanis. You know, telling the truth wasn't funny anymore. I became this freedom fighter, receiving freedom of speech awards, but my life became a mess. It was impossible to do comedy in Norway, so I thought about all the other cities I could run away to, and then I knew. I want to go to the Mecca of stand-up comedy. New York City! I wasn't feeling safe, so what did I do? I moved to New York City where nobody feels safe. And it wasn't easy to get into New York City either. The custom officer stared at my passport and said, "You have a Norwegian passport, but your name is Shabana Rehman. What exactly are you in the United States for?" So I told him that I'm here to take part in some comedy workshop. I'm a Norwegian comedian. He didn't believe me. "You're a comedian, huh? Tell me a joke." I find this thing really embarrassing, but I had to do it. So I told him the first I could come up with. Okay, did you hear about the 19-year-old Swedish virgin? No? Me neither. And he laughed. And he let me in. That's how I get in. This kind of worries me a little. Just imagine if I really was a terrorist. What if I was Mullah Krekar? Telling Swedish jokes. Well, I was in New York, Manhattan, the Big Apple, Sex and the City. Everyone can achieve their potential. Here, everyone is creative. Even the beggars are creative here. I saw a beggar with a big sign where it stood, "You can curse me as much as you want for $1. And there was a big lion in front of him. I looked at the Statue of Liberty and I thought, yes. I choose the right place. Your dreams can come true here. And I did all the tourist stuff, Ground Zero, Empire State Building, Central Park, and one of the first things I had to see when I got there was Ellis Island. Have any one of you been there? There they have this immigrant museum, all the families, what they left, what they went to, every item at the exhibition. Lice comes, old shoes, their wallets, their watches, black and white photographs, and suitcases. Suitcases from every corner of the world. And when I looked at all these suitcases that people from all over the world took with them to America, I realized this is an entire nation of people like me who are running away. And then I remembered. There is always a packed suitcase under my parents' bed in Oslo. It was there to remind mom and dad that one day they will return to their homeland, Pakistan. The suitcase was there as far back as I can remember. Sometimes, when mom and dad weren't home, I would sneak into the room and peek inside. The suitcase had a very heavy smell. There was mom's wedding clothes and the yellow sari she had on when she landed at Oslo Airport in 1978. There was jewelry there too. The veil glittered. And I found 300 love letters my father had sent to my mother. And I secretly read them. Oslo was a long way from Karachi. My dad wrote to mom, "My dear wife, it won't be long until we see each other again. How are you? Is my family looking after you okay? I found a home for us in a city called Oslo. Here, people are free. I'm working at the factory now, but soon I will get the keys to my own first store. I'm saving everything I earn. The days are long and tiring. I work night shifts too. I'm looking forward to picking you up at the airport and seeing all of you again. Did you get the money I sent you? Do you have enough for the children? Is there anything else you need? I thought what you wrote to me was so nice about the dreams you have for our children. It is possible to make it in Norway. Here, everyone, both girls and boys, can be what they want to be. Farhana will become a doctor, Shakil a lawyer, and little Shabana, she loves drawing and building things so much, she will definitely become an engineer. Okay, it's not too late. It's a nice and quiet country. Norwegians are friendly people. I like the stillness here. Guess what? It's snowing here tonight. Yours always. After we arrived, Dad continued to work all day long. Before he came home at night, Mom made herself beautiful for him. She outlined her eyes with black eyeliner, put on some red lipstick and red nail polish. She braided her long black hair that reached all the way down to her waist, dressed in glittering chiffon and silk, and wet her hands with soapy water so that she could let all her bracelets slip down over her wrists. And when Dad at last rang the doorbell, I saw his transformation. He changed his work clothes. It was like he was putting away his whole workday, and he put on soft cotton clothes. After washing himself, he would sit down, calm and smile, and eat mom's delicious food with us. They were so beautiful, so proud, as they sat there asking us kids how our days have been. We were seven children. And when you have seven children in the house, there are birthday parties all year around. And every time it was one of the kids' birthday, it was Dad who made the food. He cooked samosas, those are Pakistani dumplings, and he cooked them for the whole neighborhood. There were balloons, new clothes for the kids, and he sang happy birthday loudest out of everyone. Happy birthday to you! Happy birthday to you! Happy birthday! I was so embarrassed. And this wasn't just on birthdays. Every day was a party when Dad came home from work. And one day, one of our neighbors, Torvald, had enough of the party happy family who played Bollywood music all around the clock. He rang the doorbell and he shouted, hey, could you please put a lid on in there? And my father, he just smiled and said, no lid here, boss, you want a samosa? Torvald and father became friends. But one day, they have one beer too much. Torvald asked my father, why do you Pakistanis have so many kids? And my father, he smiled and said, why do Norwegian kids have so many parents? I was thinking all these memories while I had to run away from Norway and start my life on the ground again. And it was tough. It was tough being alone in Brooklyn and not to do what I was used to do in Norway. And in the end, I couldn't afford to go out, not even to see a comedy show. And then I went to, they have this $1 store in Brooklyn. And I went there just to buy food. And then there was a man behind the cashier. He looked at me and my credit card and he said, are you a Muslim? You know, I didn't want to get into discussion with strangers about that I don't really believe. And I was so down and I couldn't understand why he was asking me that question. So I just said, yes, whatever, can I pay? And then he frowned at me and said, why haven't you covered your head, sister? And then I said to him, like, it was almost he was urging me to do it, a totally stranger man. And I said, excuse me, I would never presume to criticize your sense of fashion or tell you which fairy stories you should read, Donald Duck, the Quran, or the Bible. Who do you think you are? Well, no, I didn't say that. Instead, I just did that. You know, then I realized no matter where that the battle wasn't over, no matter where you go to the world, the demons will follow you. And I realized that I had to go back. My father moved to Norway to experience freedom, to dream about the future, and I had to run away from Norway, his freedom dream, because I wasn't free there anymore. But how long could we be running? It must stop someplace. So I decided I'm going back. I'm going back to Norway. And I still was a famous mullah lifter. And I was offered a very well-paid job to lift the mayor of Stavanger. And getting lifted by me became a status symbol in Norway. I was getting hired to lift business leaders, political leaders, sports stars, and other celebrities. People stopped me in the street and asked me to lift them. Most amazed, there was a video game of me lifting the mullah. So this is the story. This was not my dream of how to make a living. But I tried to think positively about it, but it was hard to think positive because my mother, she wasn't pleased. She said, you become a big star in Norway for what, lifting mullah? You call this a job? And I said, Mom, I'm just trying to build an understanding between cultures. I was awarded the Freedom of Speech Prize. And Mom said, yes, yes, Obama is also trying to build bridges and they gave him the Nobel Peace Prize, but I didn't see his ass. Do you think they're going to make up a new category in the Academy Awards for you? The most outstanding Muslim butt? Why can't you work with computers? Why can't you get a decent job? Why? Thank you very much. I promise you a little lifting technique I have to show on him. Yes, I am. The technique is like this. You have to put your hands around the mullah, under his ass.
Mullah Faribor.
And not have high heels. That's important.
Woo woo! Thank you very much, Shabana Rahman. Thank you.